This is Johnny Bunting Jr. There's a song from a soundtrack years ago called The Best Things in Life Are Free. It was Janet Jackson and Luther Vandross singing. Now, the best things in life are free. All right, love, family, friends. Those things are free, and those things are really good. Now, let's talk about some things that doesn't cost you anything. It doesn't cost you anything to be a bum. It doesn't cost you anything to be a nobody. It doesn't cost you anything to be a total failure. You don't have to do anything. You don't have to be put forth any real effort to be any of those things. You don't have to work hard at it. No need to practice. You could just wake up every morning. Just wake up every morning. There's no real effort to do anything after that. If you don't want to accomplish anything, no need to put in forth any effort. Being broke. Here's the deal. There's a lot of people who work hard. And they work hard and they do not have anything to show for it. Now, there are reasons behind that. Some work hard and don't have anything to show for it because of the wages. That's one aspect of it. I'm not sure what the minimum wage is right now, but for the sake of being wrong, I'm gonna err on the side of caution since I live in New York. I believe it's 12 an hour is the minimum. I could be wrong. But if you have a full-time job, 40 hours a week, 12 hours an hour, 480. That would be 480 a week if you work 40 hours. 40 times 12 is 480. Now, taxes, I'm not sure how much taxes is taken out of the wages, but for the sake of discussion to try to make it seem somewhere near what it's supposed to be, I'm going to say 30%. So 30% out of 480, $144, 480 take away $144 is $336. So say you bring home $336 a week. $336 don't seem like a whole lot. Okay. Now multiply that times four. $336 times 4. 3, 6, 9, 12, 36, 72, 144. So that's 12 plus 144, 1344. 1344 a month. Now, depending on where you live and what other things you have, meaning, do you rent a room? Do you rent an apartment? Do you have a car? Do you have insurances of any kind? That money can be eaten up relatively quickly. So you can work hard and have nothing to show for it, depending on your lifestyle and wages. So push that up, take it from 12, make it $20 an hour. $20 an hour, same $40, 40 hours a week. Now, instead of the 480, you're at 800. And using the same 30%, we're going to go 240. So that'll be 560. 560 a week, 560 times 4, 10, 15, 20, 6 times 4 is 24, 2240. 2240 a month gives you more wiggle room. Rent, depending on, you know, one bedroom, two bedroom, studio, what have you, car, insurance, so on and so forth. It can be daunting. It can be frustrating, especially if you're by yourself. If you are, and what I mean by yourself is if you are alone by yourself, that can be difficult. But if you are not alone, but you're the sole breadwinner, that can be even more frustrating. If you have children, dependents of any sort, if you have a spouse, a mate, what have you, and they are not working or having any income, that can be really frustrating. But the point I am making is that that can be frustrating, but by working hard, you still open the door to something greater. There's probably a bunch of people that can contest to what I'm getting ready to say. There's has been oftentimes in my life where it seemed like things were becoming overbearing. Like, yo, this is too much. I can't do this, blah, blah, blah. Whatever the case may be. And right as it reached its peak of frustration, a door opened up to something better. And it was like, I'm glad I didn't give up, because this opened up. Now, there may be situations where things aren't going well and it's not for you. Now, giving up, moving on. Let's call it that. I had a car wash. It became frustrating. I have more than one business, so my other business was starting to pick up more. So I had to be away from the car wash. People at the car wash were not performing well. They were sluggish, not cleaning well, not showing up on time. Basically, anything that could ruin a business was happening one way or another. And it didn't have to be consistently happening on a daily basis, like showing up late every day. But yeah, pretty much showing up late every day. But some of these things, it's just wasn't feasible. Like, okay, listen, I have to be here. I can't be at two places at once. So if this is not working right and it's becoming too frustrating, it's not, it has outlived its goodness. The promise that I saw has came and gone. And now that I'm working on something else, this is not performing to my expectations. So my best bet is to let it go before it tanks. So sometimes you have to make a business decision when you're doing business. And even in a job, sometimes you have to, for instance, let's say you have a job and you have a supervisor that has it in for you for whatever reason. Could be a personal thing that you and that person do not see eye to eye. It could be something else. Things are going on at the job that are making you not either perform to the expectations, or you don't feel comfortable with what's going on at the job. And instead of sitting there and have it ruin you and make you bitter and mess you up, move on. Sometimes it's not as easy as saying, yo, I quit, I'm gone, because you need the paycheck. Sometimes you have to get yourself prepared for the move. And what I mean by that is look for something else while you're still doing that. And then when you find it, then you move. There's a saying that I say, do what you can until you can do what you want. So it's like, listen, here's the deal. I'm in something that I do not like, but right now it's paying the bills. So I'm going to look for something else that I like better. Once I find it, then I can transition. It is not wise to say, I quit, I'm out of here, F this, bam, and then go, and you have no backup. Because a lot of people do that to spare the moment out of emotion. And then when they go home, they're like, yo, I messed up. Or someone else tells them, what happened? Family, the kids, you know, they may not say this, but like, listen, well, we have a bill. Or we got these school supplies we got to buy. Or there's a food drive coming up at the school. So there's something that's requiring some extra money that is no longer there. So it's like, why did you do that? Couldn't you have waited? Couldn't you have found something else? Now you're at a sense of urgency to find something else. And then you may end up in another bad situation because of desperation. When you are desperate, you do stuff out of haste, and then you end up taking something that you do not like. It might be worse than what you left. So all I'm trying to impart to you is that it doesn't take a lot of effort to be a bum, but it takes effort to be successful. What type of effort, do you ask? Well, it depends on the level of success that you want and what you're doing. For instance, I've been home, January will make 8 years. So depending on the glass is full, the glass, depending on the way a person looks at it, by virtue of being out free, no parole, that is a level of success. That is a level of success. Am I satisfied with just that? No. So, therefore, not being satisfied with just that, you have to set your sights on goals, short-term goals. For instance, I know people come home, short-term goal is get a job, get some sort of income. Now, I've actually helped people with jobs, give them jobs, whether it been at the car wash or cleaning yards or shoveling snow or, you know, doing some stuff on a computer. There's a lot of work from home gigs. I put people on to certain things like that. There's something that I used to do that I actually put people on to. It's gigs, but they actually have a job where you can do this as a 9 to 5 or whatever the hours are, part-time or what have you. But the way I did it was gigs. And I was a brand ambassador. That was the actual term that they use. So it sound good, sound important. Basically what I was doing, and you've probably seen this, if you've been to BJ's, Costco's, Walmart? Whatever, some of the big stores. You may see somebody that's standing at a table that has some samples or they have some free stuff they want to give away because they're promoting a brand, they're promoting a product. They want you to give it a taste test or this, that, and the third. Not a taste test, but take a sample so that you could taste it and then see if you like it. If you like it, they can direct you to where to purchase it from. Some may actually have some there for you to pick up and buy. Now, that wasn't what I wanted to do. No. But I was put onto it actually by my wife. She showed me the ropes. I did it, and what I became a member, and I had to go online and look for gigs. So the way I did it was, I went online, I looked for gigs that was near me, or if they wasn't actually near me, I had like a zone, like, okay, I was living in Mount Vernon at the time. So I was looking Mount Vernon, Yonkers, New Rochelle, White Plains. I was Bronx. I was looking for that little zone. And I would book or apply for some in those areas. And sometimes, like, I found something in Porchester that was a ongoing gig. So, and what I mean by that, it had more than one time appearance. One of them had like six appearances. So it was like when you sign up, you have to be available for the six dates. So those were gigs that spread it out. And the average pay at the time was, the low end was like 80. The high end was 125 or something like that for the day. And the day was usually 4 to 5 hours. So I put in for those. Now, that wasn't my cup of tea, so to speak. Like me standing for 4 or 5 hours, it wasn't something that I couldn't do because I could do that easily. Approaching people, walking past, hey, how you doing? Blah, blah, blah. That really wasn't me. But I was up for the challenge because not only was it putting me in a position to earn some money legitimately, it was actually putting me in a position to expand my horizons because that wasn't my comfort zone. Saying, hey, how you doing? Would you like to test this product? That wasn't my comfort zone. But what I did was, is I looked at it as kind of like a performance and strategically, like, how can I get these people to stop and talk to me? I looked at everything a little bit differently. Sometimes I had a snacks. So if I got a snack, then if I see a kid with a parent, of course, I can say hello to the parent, but target the kid. Hey, would you like this? Oh, is it all right for him or her to have some? Boom, boom. And got the kid smiling. Hey, mommy or daddy, can I get that? Boom. If there's no kids, the lady, hey, how you doing? With a smile. If you seem more approachable, friendly, they'll come. I had women just come up just to talk to me just because of me being approachable. And then say, what you got going on? Well, I have this, that, and the third, boom, boom, boom. Guys, different. Guys don't really care about a smile, but they don't want you grilling them either. So it'd be more like, hey, what's up, bro? How you doing? Boom. Because to ease down on the machismo, to be more approachable, what's up, bro? And then some of them might even be like, yo, yeah, I done did some time, but especially if they look familiar. Yo, you been up north? A lot of brothers been locked up. So a lot of them don't even take offense. If you haven't been locked up, you know somebody been locked up. And then next thing you know, I have a person that's talking to me. And then this is what's going on. And I also got cool with the people in the store, the workers in the store, because oftentimes whatever I'm giving away, I can give them samples as well. They don't mind. And it also made it easier because someone I had to report to at the store in order for me to sign in, get the equipment, sign out, put the equipment back. If I had to use some of their equipment, sometimes I just came with my own stuff and therefore I just set up, but I still have to sign in and sign out. So these are things that I had to do in order to get myself from one phase to the next, get myself from being able to create some type of income, because this income was not great. Like I said, when you're dealing with 4 to 5 hours and you're dealing with about $180 to $100, you're looking at like $20 to $25 an hour. Yeah, you are. But if you have 1 gig, 2 gigs per week, and you don't get paid till a month later, I'm telling you the facts of what I experienced. I'm not saying every situation is like this. This was my experience. So what I did was, is I started piling them on, meaning I'm like, okay, well, I can get a gig on Saturday, a gig on Sunday. Sometimes, depending on the time of the gigs, I might be able to double up. For instance, there was times when I'm going to do a Mount Vernon gig Saturday morning. I'm going to do a Bronx gig in the afternoon. Because by the time I'm finished with the Mount Vernon, I got like a half hour to get to the Bronx. And Mount Vernon and the Bronx aren't far apart from each other. It just depends on the place in the Bronx that I have to go to. But I was able to do it. So just look at it like that. A couple of times I was able to stack my Saturday and Sunday where I had 2 and 2. So just that weekend is $400. But I got to wait a month to get it. So when they had gigs that had multiple appearances, like, okay, well, listen, this is a 6-week gig. So every Saturday and Sunday, I have to be in Portchester to do this for 6 weeks. Okay. When you have a bit, when you have a bigger gig like that, they pay a little more. So it's like, okay, well, this is my 125. So I'm making 250 a weekend for 6 weeks. So at the fourth week, I'm getting paid for the first week. And then 5, 6, now I'm having money coming in each week after that to catch up. So that's basically what I did. I started stacking my weeks, finding stuff. If I could find a Friday gig, I'll find a Friday gig. And like the holiday season, they did have bigger gigs, more days, better pay, some of them longer hours, that's why. And I'll stack them up so that I can have money coming in weekly. It wasn't a big deal. And what I mean by that is, it's not like it was a 9 to 5 on a daily basis. But although it wasn't for me, when I went to Costco's to do the Christmas gig, and I had to do it for, I don't remember the exact amount of days, but I had to do it consecutive days. I'm not sure if it was the whole week, but I had to do it a few days straight. But they had people that actually worked there. That was their job. I was extra for the Christmas, boost of sales and customers and product. So I was extra, but you had people that was there every day. And the funny thing is when I spoke to them, and we was transparent, at least I was transparent, maybe they was, maybe they wasn't. And when we spoke about pay, I was making more money than them, but they had a long-term joint. Like, I'm making more money for you in these 4 days, and then I'm gone, and then you're still going to make your money, your $14 or whatever, for the rest of your career there. But the whole point is, like I said, do what you can until you can do what you want. Because I had no intention on making that a long-term thing. Would I do that right now? Probably not. But I don't have any bad taste about it. So if, like, let's say, for instance, if I had somebody that I was trying to coach into doing that. And I'm like, yo, listen, I'll go with you and I'll do it like to help you train. I have no problem doing that as long as I have the time. If I have the time, go there, boom, because my wife was trained me. It was like, okay, well, she showed me how to do it. I went with her. We did it. She was pregnant at the time. We was getting extra money so that my daughter can have some extra stuff, you know, when she came through. And that's how I learned. Then I just took over. I actually was taking over doing my wife's stuff first, and then I signed up. And then I just put extra effort when I do stuff. I just start looking at ways to, you know, turn it into a real, that's just how I am. So I would tell somebody else, this is how you do it, boom, and this is how you make it work for you the best way possible. The best way possible, like I said, is how I did it. It was best for me, is I got cool with the staff. Because what you do not want is you do not want to be in a position where you're late and they nitpick with you about being late. Because people have lost their little positions for being late. I was early all the time because that's just how I am. And I mean, I was early, early. Like sometimes I was there a half hour early. They'd be like, you're not supposed to start yet. I was like, no, I'm just here. You see, I'm here. I'm going to sign up, get the stuff ready and all that. And then when it comes time, I'll, you know, do my thing. Or I'll walk around until it's, you know, like 5 minutes, 10 minutes till I have to get going, and then I'll set up. But the whole point is that the staff saw me there. So if it would have came to a point where I'm 5 minutes late, they were like, if something had to happen, because he's always super early. So there was never a conflict. And I mean, every time I didn't always arrive 30 minutes early. Sometimes I was there 10 minutes, 15 minutes early, but I was still there early. And like I said, I established a rapport with the supervisors. There were several of them, because depending on what place I went to, I was in the Bronx and Mount Vernon and New Rochelle and Mount Vernon. I mean, White Plains, Port Chester. I even was in Rockland, had to do a gig in Rockland a few times, come over there. And same thing, smile, approach, get things, learn, teach me where I got to put stuff at. Is it possible for me to put stuff back when I'm finished without calling you? I don't want to disturb you. Just tell me what I have to do and I'll do it. Make things smoother for everybody. And they like that. And bam, there you go. Put in your work, put in your effort, because the new hustle is getting multiple things going on. You need multiple incomes. Back when I was younger, the hustle, you was selling drugs. Some people did their little stick up. Some people stole cars and all this. All these things had jailhouse waiting at the end of it. Now, new thing, you have a lot of people that aren't even thinking about nothing illegal. They don't have to. They got multiple things that they can do to create some type of income. And it can be time consuming. It can be. But it also can be rewarding if you're putting it together the right way. Because you can be home and be on a computer making money. And if you're on a computer making money, you're at home, you can take breaks when you need to take breaks, stretch, go to the bathroom. You can have TV on in the background, radio, whatever. Boom, depending on what you're doing. If you're on the phone, like some people work from home and they're on the phone, I guess you can't be having a TV and radio playing while you're on the phone. But the whole point is you still be at the comfort of your home. You could be chilling.